Good evening and welcome to Writers on Writing. I am your host, Dr. Brenda Greene, and we are coming to you from the studios of Mega Rivers College over the airways of 91.5 FM. Writers on Writing comes to you every Sunday evening at 7 p.m. and gives you, our listening audience, an opportunity to hear writers from the African diaspora talk about their work, their craft, and their lives. And I want to thank my engineer, Fritz Richardson, for always being there. I also want to give you the name of the person in the background whose theme music we use every week. That's Gary Bartz, I've Known Rivers, which I think fits in very well with our literary objective here of sharing with you, our listening audience. I'm very pleased to have with me this evening on the telephone the internationally renowned poet and author, Lorna Goodison. Welcome, Lorna.
Oh, hello, Brenda. Hello. Very nice of you to have me.
I'm so pleased to have you and to listen to you read and discuss your work and your recent books. Lorna Goodison, as I stated, is an internationally renowned poet and author of the highly acclaimed memoir From Harvey River, a book that was hailed as captivating in the New York Times and named a Washington Post Book World Best Book of the Year. She is the recipient of the Musgrave Gold Medal and the Commonwealth Writers' Prizes, among other accolades. Her work has been widely translated and anthologized in major collections of contemporary poetry. She is originally from Jamaica and now teaches at the University of Michigan. And her most recent wonderful book of short stories is By Love Possessed. So we are very pleased to have you here in our studio, Lorna.
It's lovely to be in New York, even if it's being in New York on the radio. I like being there.
Yes. So, you know, when we first talked, I had not read your memoir, which I really, really enjoyed. From Harvey River, A Memoir of My Mother and Her Island. So why don't we begin? Let's begin there, and then we'll go into By Love Possessed, which had me laughing and very sad sometimes. And I think is some of the stories so many women can relate to. But let's begin with From Harvey River. Why were you motivated to write this memoir?
Well, two things. I wanted to make sense of my mother's dying, you know. I think, like many people, I didn't think my mother would ever die. I mean, that's silly, but it's true. You never, I never imagined that there'd be a time when she would not be alive and around, you know, for me to say things, to
right.
ask questions. And I spent a lot of time with her before she died, and she was very insistent that, you know, she was telling her family stories with a kind of intensity that I felt I needed to pay attention to them. And also, I've always, in my mind, been hoping and thinking about and toying with the idea of writing some sort of history of Jamaica. I almost read history, but I didn't. But a lot of my poems, if you know my poetry at all, and my stories are informed by historical events. Some of them, I always say I did history from below.
Yes, I like that term. I like that term. So can you talk a little bit about your writing life when you began writing, which I guess comes up through this whole writing of your memoir, when you began writing, your life as a writer?
Well, I for a long time I thought I was a painter who wrote. I studied art in Jamaica and at the Art Students League on West 57th Street in New York. And I always thought I was a painter who wrote on the side because my sister is a journalist. And as I've often said, that in a big family, the dynamics, you know, are very, very, can get very complicated. So one of the things I always thought is that I could not be a writer because my sister was already, there already was a writer in the family.
Right.
You know, so, but I always say, and this is not to be melodramatic, is that I write because I have to.
Yes, and I
don't have much of a choice in the matter, you know.
But you're saying you write because you have to, and you paint. Your writing is filled with so many images.
I don't paint anymore.
But no, I'm saying that symbolically, that your words convey paintings.
Well, I guess
your words arouse our senses. Your words contain, give us vivid descriptions.
Yes.
You really take your time to paint a picture of what the lake looked, I mean, the river looked like, or what a person looked like, what they was wearing. You really take your time with that. So details and arousing the senses is very important to you. It's very clear when you look at the way you use language. And of course, poetry, your language is very poetic, so that in your short stories, in your memoir, you have poetry. You represent in my view, what I'm looking at is the artist who is using the literary and the visual arts and the performance, and even the way you read. It's all coming together.
Thank you. I suspect that is what I'm trying to do. I never set out to, I never set out to say this is what I'm going to do. I didn't have any kind of manifesto.
Right.
I came up with that, said I would like my work to do this or that. But I think that's a big compliment, and thank you very much for saying that.
You're welcome. You're very welcome and well-deserving. So just going back to From Harvey River, a large part of it is how what life was like for the Harvey girls, along with your mother, and as you said, the history around independence. Just share with us somewhat of what that life was like.
Well, obviously I didn't live at that time, so I depended heavily on my mother's stories.
Right.
And I was fortunate, and my two of my aunts were alive, and I got some of their stories before they passed on. And then my Aunt Anne, who was the very last one alive, was the very last member of the Harvey family from whom I got information. She lived in Montreal. So when I moved to Canada in 2000, I spent some good time with her, just listening to her tell me stories. And based on that, I put it together. And then I also did a lot of reading. I read newspapers that were published at that time. I read any kind of history written at that time, accounts of, what was happening in Jamaica at that time. And then I also dreamt some of it, some of the dialogue. Seriously, I would go to sleep and I would dream some of it. And sometimes when I was writing it, there were particular characters who, really wanted to take over the book. My maternal great-grandfather, for example, the Irishman George O'Brien Wilson. Anytime I went to write anything about him, I'd just know exactly what to say. And it was a very interesting experience. I don't want to be, melodramatic or just say anything I shouldn't say. But I do feel that there were times when I felt I was cooperating with some of these people who wanted their stories told. And that's as much as I will say. I won't say anything more about that.
Okay. And why don't you share with us from Harvey River? Share with us an excerpt.
Fine. I'll read from the very beginning, the prologue and the first few pages of the book, of chapter one.
Okay.
Throughout her life, my mother lived in two places at once: Kingston, Jamaica, where she raised a family of nine children, and Harvey River in the parish of Hanover, where she was born and grew up. Harvey River had been settled by her grandfather, William Harvey, who gave his name to the river, and the river in turn gave its name to the village. I do not think that there was ever a day in my childhood when the river or the village was not mentioned in our house. Over the years, Harvey River came to function as an enchanted place in my imagination, an Eden from which we fell to the city of Kingston. But over time, I have come to see that my parents' story is really a story about rising up to a new life. As a child, I constantly asked my mother about her life before, as she put it, things changed. I listened carefully to her stories and repeated them to myself. I also took to asking urgent questions of my father. I have an image of me standing outside the bathroom door, calling into him over the noise of the shower. So what was your mother's name? And what was her mother's name? But my father's people do not live long, and he died when I was 15 years old. So I never did get to ask him all my questions. After my mother Doris's death, nearly 35 years later, I began to dream her, as Jamaicans say. And in those dreams, I continued to ask her questions about her life before and after she came to Kingston. And then there was this one very vivid visitation where I dreamt that I went to see her in her new residence, a really palatial and splendid sewing room with high stained glass windows, where she's now in charge of sewing gorgeous garments for top-ranking angels. She said that they were paying her a lot for her sewing in this place, and that all her friends came to talk angelic big woman business with her there as she sewed. She said she could not tell me more, as she did not want me to stay with her too long, because the living should not mix up too much with the dead. But as I was leaving the celestial workroom, she handed me a book. This is that book.
Thank you.
Do I have enough time to read two pages from the first,
yes,
the opening chapter?
Yes.
Okay. The baby was plump and pretty as a ripe oxheart tomato. Her mother, Margaret Wilson Harvey, gently squeezed the soft cheeks to open the tiny mouth and rubbed her little finger, which had been dipped in sugar, back and forth, over and under the small tongue, to anoint the child with the gift of sweet speech. Her name is Doris, she said to her husband, David. In later years, my mother preferred to spell her name D-O-R-I-C-E, although in actual fact, she was christened D-O-R-I-S. But she was registered under a different name altogether, Clarabel. This came about because of a disagreement between her parents as to what they should call their seventh child. Her father, David, was a romantic and a dreamer, a man who loved music and books, and an avid reader of lesser-known 19th century authors. He had read a book in which the heroine was called Clarabel, and he found it to be a lovely and fitting name. He told his wife, Margaret, that this was to be the baby's name. Well, Margaret had her heart set on Doris because it was the name of a school friend of hers, a real person, not some made-up somebody who lived in a book. Doris Louise, that was what the child would be called. They argued over it, and after a while it became clear that Margaret was not going to let David best her this time. He had given their other children names like Cleodine, Alberta, Edmund, and Flavius. Lofty-sounding names, which were rapidly hacked down to size by the blunt tongues of Hanover people. Cleo, Bertie, Eddie, and Flavie. That was what remained of those names when Hanover people were finished with them. Margaret had managed to name her firstborn son Howard, and her father had named Rose. Simple names for real people. There was nobody who could be as stubborn and hard-headed as Margaret when she set her mind to something. She was determined that her baby was not going to be called Clarabel. Sound like a blasted cow name, she had said. David gave up arguing with his wife about the business of naming the pretty-faced, chubby little girl, especially after Margaret reminded him graphically of who exactly had endured the necessary hard and bloody labor to bring the child into the world. He dutifully accompanied her to church and christened the baby Doris on the last Sunday in June 1910. And then the next day, he rode into the town of Lucy and registered the child as Clarabel Louise Harvey. And he never told anybody about this deed for 15 years.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, he's not known to have actually told anybody about it, because the family only found out when my mother tried to sit for her first Jamaica local exams, for which she needed her birth certificate. And when they went to the registrar of births and deaths, they told her that there was no Doris Louise Harvey on record, but that there was a Clarabel Louise Harvey, born to David and Margaret Harvey, née Wilson of Harvey River. She burst into tears when she heard what her legal name was. Clarabel go to hell, her brothers chanted, when the terrible truth was revealed. And not one to take teasing lightly, she told them to go to hell their damn selves. Eventually, her name was converted by a deed poll to Doris, and thereafter she signed her name D-O-R-I-C, as if to distance herself from the whole Clarabel Doris business. Besides, Doris, conjured up images of a woman who was not ordinary. And to be ordinary, according to my mother's oldest sister, Claire Dine, was just about the worst thing that a member of the Harvey family could be.
Right. I love those stories. They're so real. I mean, we know those stories, right? We have our family stories that we tell, and they really reveal a lot about determination and culture and tradition and, you know, what we will do.
Oh, exactly.
Yes. Now, you, by Love Possessed, what was the motivation behind that? Because these stories really kind of really revolve around, you know, I always say that writers are asking a question, and one of those questions is, how can I be loved? You know, the search
Absolutely.
For love.
The thing about this book is that I wrote some of these stories a long time ago, and they were published, they had several incarnations. Once they were published in England, and then they were published in a small book with Maya Angelou and Alice Walker and another writer under the title of A Quartet of Stories. And so I'd had them on Olive Senior. They were published, you know, some years ago. Well, what happened was after I wrote the memoir, my editor, Ellen Seligman, who was born in New York, then said, and she's now the editor at McClelland and Stewart in Toronto, in Canada. She said to me, Lorna, let's look at all the fiction you've written. And so she looked at my stories, and she's very sweet and but very persuasive. And she said, I'd like for you to revisit some of these stories, because some of them were just really brief. I was very taken with the idea of what was called flash fiction at that point, just very, very short stories. Mm-hmm. And she said, you know, I love these stories, but there's something that I find deeply troubling in that the minute I get really interested in a character, the story ends. So she said, would you mind just visiting them again for me? And so I thought it wouldn't be too hard. But it took me 2 years to, once I started looking at the stories again, I just saw where I could lengthen them, deepen them, do things with them that I'd maybe learned during the process of writing the memoir. Also, so some of them are in a completely different form than the original, in that there's one story, in fact, where I just used like one paragraph from an old story, and I built an entirely different, a new story around it. And some of them have, you know, a part two where they didn't have one before. And so it is a new, it's an old book, but it's quite different, you know.
Right. Would you say there's a relationship also between some of the memories that you create and from Harvey River, and they end up getting played out in some of these stories?
Well, none of the characters from Harvey River really appear. Mm-hmm. You know, I was very careful. I really wanted to not have too much.
Well, I'm not talking about the persons. I'm talking about the memories, some of the...
And the plots, you know,
right.
the ideas of how people interact and how people... You know, I'm very interested in what... First of all, one of the things about the stories is that I think the fate, you know, plays a big part in the lives of many of the characters in this story. They have the best intentions in the world, and somehow things just don't work out the way they envision them or they want them to work out. And so I'm hoping that is evident, you know, to say that sometimes with the best will in the world, you know, the best laid plans of mice and men and all of those things, just things come a cropper and you don't intend for that to happen.
Right.
But I'm also very interested in the internal lives of Jamaican people. You know, Jamaica, you know, we very often people, there's a way in which I think about people, and I think, you know, people wouldn't probably understand that there are these deep, complicated things which drive some very ordinary Jamaican people, you know?
Now, you said they drive Jamaican people, but as I said, my family is from St. Croix in South Carolina. But I see the stories also as universal in terms of the
really
themes.
I'm really hoping so. I just said Jamaican people because, you know, the story is...
Right, they're definitely...
I said so much. But that is my prayer. That is my hope as a writer, that everything I do will resonate with human beings everywhere, because, you know, I'm one of these people. I firmly believe that we are way more alike than we're different.
Yes,
you know? And,
yes. One of my favorite stories is the help wait.
Yeah, I think a lot of women have responded to that story, because I don't think it's an unusual. story at all. I think certainly when I was growing up in Jamaica, before people remained in the Caribbean to do, you know, higher to pursue any sort of higher education, they, you know, like professional people, lawyers and doctors, would go away mostly to England to qualify to study, and very often they'd return with, you know, partners who were, you know, English or, you know, British.
Yes.
And it sometimes would get very difficult because, you know, you saw these stories being played out. But then, like, I think it's true anywhere. Somebody leaves somewhere and goes and marries a stranger and brings them back to a community. Things will always be very difficult.
Right. I think it touches that theme. But I think even the whole idea of partnerships and marriage being about getting someone who's going to be a help mate rather than a help wait, you know. And I think part of what you're doing is really talking about the cultural values and traditions among Jamaicans and many groups that we don't get to hear about. We get to hear about the tragedies, but we don't get to hear about how people persevere and how they persist and how they go on despite their, you know, unhappiness. I once heard one writer say, happiness is an unnatural state. So if you take that as your premise, I'm not saying that I believe it, but if you take it as your premise, then everything is a blessing and everything, you learn how to work it. You learn how to survive. You learn how to persist. You learn how to count your blessings.
Well, I'm so glad you read it that way because, you know, I've had people read the stories and see things that I didn't intend. You know, somebody said that she found that all the men were weak or broken or something. I didn't think so. I thought in all the stories, for every example of their, I agree with one critic who said the guys need to grow up, but they do need to grow up. And the women need to grow up too, because
exactly.
Like in that first story, the help wait, that woman gets drawn back into a relationship with, because she's still very much thinking about her first school, her love that was her high school sweetheart.
Yes.
You know, and she needed to grow up.
She needs to grow up, know? Right. Because you the values that I see coming out of here is that, you know, we need to deal with our demons. We need to deal with that inner life. And we also need to address, like, to what extent do we compromise on our integrity?
Precisely, yes.
Yes. And the other thing I noticed in the stories is that really the impact of music and dance seems to really have impact on many of the stories. Was that something, would you say that's something that was very important to you
personally? Very,
very personally?
Important to me, yes. And I will tell you, the last story I come through where the main character is in fact a singer. And you could say that she was saved by her gift, you know, she was given away as a child. One of the things I wanted to speak about in that story, to examine, you know, I come from a huge family. I have 8 siblings. I cannot walk on the streets of Kingston without meeting somebody to whom I'm related or who doesn't know my family. So I don't know. I had to imagine what it must be like to not know who your birth parents are, to never have any knowledge of who you're, people who are adopted or don't know their birth parents.
Right.
And this lady was given away, on the main character was, as a child, she was given away on the street.
Yes.
And again, that story used to be a very familiar story when I was growing up. I don't know if it was true where you come from, but certainly before things like, you know, adoption agencies became, you know, things that people went through.
No, that's not something Black people went to. You went with your family. That's right. You went with family and friends.
And if you didn't, you know, I'm sure you would have heard of those stories of somebody, usually a young girl who had a child she couldn't look after. And she'd just go and maybe see somebody with a kind face and say, would you hold this baby for me? And then
yes.
She'd just disappear.
Yes. I don't know how many of those, I'm sure that happened, but you did have many instances where the whole village coming together. When I say
exactly.
The village, the members, you took care of the family and friends and loved ones. That's how we survived.
Exactly. Well, I wanted to mention these things because I know that they happen, and I'm... One of my concerns as a writer is that I want to put down these stories because I don't want them to disappear.
Yes, and that's very important. And, you know, as we come to a close, I always imagine that a writer is having also conversations with other writers. And who are some of the writers who you might say you're having conversations with, and if you can tie that into what message can you give to writers, emerging writers in our audience?
Well, I certainly, you know, somebody like Zora Neale Hurston, I'm certainly trying to have a conversation with, particularly in the Battle of Possessed stories. Toni Cade Bambara, whom I think she's just one of the most wonderful writers, because she writes out of a place of deep love for her people. I mean, I think James Baldwin is another writer like that, where you can tell that their love for where they come from, who their people are, is just boundless. They write out of this compassion and love for the people. And I'm hoping I'm doing something like that. I'm also in conversation with certainly some Jamaican writers, like Vic Reed, who was a Jamaican writer, you know, who, when I first read his books like New Day, I thought about, yeah, you could, I like the way he was talking about Jamaican people. Derek Walcott has been a huge influence on my life. He's the one who has helped to shape my poetic voice more than any other writer, any other poet, bar none. His influence is the largest in my life, as a, you know, when it comes to my poetry. So I'm having a conversation with all of these people and people from a long ago, people I couldn't possibly have met, you know.
Yes, exactly. And the message that you have for emerging writers?
I like what you said at the beginning, that you think my work is being influenced and shaped by all these different, you know, by art and music. And
yes.
It is. And one of the things, I was fortunate enough to have taken some classes from the great Jacob Lawrence.
Okay.
And at our Students League. And funnily, I realize now that meeting Mr. Lawrence at that point has helped me so much as a writer. Because he was not one to spend a lot of time arguing about work or anything. When you try to engage him in any kind of complicated discussions about a painting, he said, "Lorna, just go do your work." And a lot of time, and I realize now that if you want to get your work done, this is what I'd say to young writers: do your work. You don't get too involved in anything that is going to take you away from doing your work.
Right, and that goes into what you're saying in terms of writing from the heart. I want to thank you so much for sharing your story and for reading with us and for writing such wonderful books and wonderful stories and wonderful poetry. And I want to encourage our listening audience to please support our writers. Pick up Order by Love Possessed, Stories by Lorna Goodison, or From Harvey River, or both.
Thank you so much, Brenda. It's so kind of you. And I guess we're out of time.
Yes, we are.
Okay, all right.
So I want to thank you once again and remind our listeners that the writer is always reading, the reader is always writing. Keep reading and writing. Empower yourselves as readers and writers. And come back next week. Writers on Writing, Dr. Brenda Greene signing off.
Song was inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes. I'm sure most of you have heard of Langston Hughes. And he wrote a poem about rivers. And we call this song, I've Known Rivers.